Hi everyone, and welcome back to our channel. By popular demand, we're continuing our series of translated videos about tanks, once again from a Ukrainian tanker known as Shaushenk. His brilliant, professional, and engaging breakdowns of how different systems and entire tanks work give everyday viewers a rare glimpse into the fascinating world of armored vehicles. We also encourage everyone watching our translations to check out his original channel. Even if you don't speak Russian or Ukrainian, go ahead and subscribe. It supports the creator in his language community and helps bring more great videos like this. You'll find the links to the original video and to his channel down in the description. And don't forget to subscribe to our channel too. Drop a like or even a dislike and leave your comments. It really helps the channel grow. Well then, let's get started. All right, this is a T-72B3. Could be the M version, or maybe the 2016 model. The vehicle's in much better condition, almost brand new. You can still smell the fresh paint in here. The gun's in great shape too. Honestly, it's actually nice to sit inside when everything's this clean. As for any changes inside, I don't see a single one so far. Same old issues. From the awkward stabilizer switch, to the cramped space, to the poor visibility of the azimuth indicator. Everything's right where it always was. Same thermal sight. Here it is, the Sosna-U. Same magnification, 4x and 12x. Same one A40 sight. Basically, everything inside is exactly the same. Same old autoloader system. I'll show the commander's station later. Of course, compared to the T-90, it's just as cramped as ever. You can barely move around. See? I'm sitting here tight against the panel, and that's me trying to lean to the right. So yeah, this is basically how you sit in it for real. Exactly the same quirks, no difference at all. Honestly, I don't even know what new I could show here. By the way, I'll record separate videos for both the T-90 and the 2016 T-72B3 to show the vertical and horizontal traverse speeds. What I can say for sure, I tested this T-72 myself, and yeah, the turret turns faster when slewing. It's about 30, maybe 35 degrees per second. So yeah, horizontally it's quicker, but in vertical elevation, even with the control stick pushed all the way, it's still around 3.5 degrees per second, same as always. Honestly, maybe even a bit slower than I'm used to seeing. So basically, no real difference, no changes whatsoever. You can tell the stabilizer here is a hydraulic type. See those two hoses? That's the hydraulic fluid being pumped in. So yeah, not an electric stabilizer here. I mean the power cylinder that elevates the gun up and down. That's basically how it is. Anything new? Can't say there's a single new thing, honestly. Same problem with the hatches. Still a pain to climb out. And yeah, I've been saying this for ages. Nothing's changed over the years. And as always, the anti-aircraft machine gun mount. Either the hatch is forward or the AA mount is forward. Never both. So yeah, seems like the factory guys didn't draw any conclusions from that. All right, the seat back's removed here. The guys are doing some work. Still, what's nice, this machine is really fresh, almost untouched. Didn't see much action. So yeah, that's how it is. Here's a standard TKN-3MK periscope. See the marking? Nothing new here, either. This is the duplicate screen. It shows the same thermal image the gunner sees. and that's the backup turret control panel. Same as before, no independent rangefinder here. Basically, the only difference is, you're shooting through the gunner's thermal image feed. But if the gunner's sight head is hit, you'll be firing by eye through the TKN, nothing else. These are all the radio units. Thermal imager control module. More radio blocks here, and this big box here. That's part of the radio system, too. Ammo boxes for the coaxial 7.62mm PKT machine gun. And there's the PKT itself. So yeah, that's roughly the situation inside. Inside, I don't see any radical differences. Actually, no differences at all. From a standard B3, say, the 2014 version or whatever year it was. They're practically identical machines. Honestly, I see no difference whatsoever. What does surprise me, though, is the number of counterweights. These ones right here. These plates bolted on here. They're used to balance the gun on its trunnions. Normally, at least on the T-64, the gun was balanced together with a round and propellant in the barrel. Ideally, it should tip slightly forward, toward the muzzle. Right toward the gun's muzzle end. And usually you'd see about this many counterweight plates at the breech end. But here, there's even more. I don't know, honestly, kind of weird seeing so many of them. Alright, maybe the gun cradle or breech guard design has been slightly modified. Could be arranged differently here. Anyway, that's how it looks. Now I'll show you the outside. The biggest changes on this tank are all on the outside. First thing that catches your eye, they've added explosive reactive armor here. Of course, they only added the lower plate. The upper one's just a cover, there's nothing behind it. So they've covered that most obvious weak spot, so to speak. Speaking of the Sosna-U thermal sight, I wanted to touch on why its head is so big. This whole thing here is the output window. It's divided into four separate channels. One for the optical daytime channel. One for the laser rangefinder. One for the laser beam guidance system for missiles. And this big one here, made of gallium glass. That's the thermal imaging channel. The reason it's so large is to produce a higher quality image. Because the matrix surface area makes a huge difference in image quality. And for comparison, here's the one A40 site. As far as I know, it's got three channels. Optical, laser, and missile guidance, if I'm not mistaken. See how small it is? And look how huge this one is. That's all because of the thermal channel. Naturally, the bigger it is, the easier it is to hit and damage. So, yeah, draw your own conclusions. Finally, they've added proper side protection with reactive armor. They've also added these flaps designed to mask the heated running gear in the infrared spectrum. Overall, positive changes, some of the most noticeable ones. So yeah, that's pretty much the situation. The coverage looks solid overall. The engine here is more powerful, about 1130 horsepower, give or take. Here's what the armor sections look like. There's a small weak spot here naturally, but it's tiny, not really a big deal. Inside, sandwiched between these metal plates, are rubber frames that hold the standard reactive armor tiles we're used to.
с динамической защитой.
So that's basically how it's set up. And here's something else I wanted to mention about that earlier video where I talked about suspension travel. See the gap between the top of the track and the road wheel? That's the main thing limiting its vertical travel. It simply can't move any higher. The geometry just doesn't allow it. The suspension's been freshly greased too. You can still see the lubricant marks. As for the glacis plate, nothing new there. Still partial coverage. And on the turret, no major changes either. Actually, wait, there are a few changes. Let me show you what I mean. There are these boxes mounted here. Inside them are cells filled with something that looks like a ceramic material. They're arranged like this, alternating with the reactive armor plates. So it's basically extra protection for the vulnerable rear half of the turret. From what I understand, it's meant to protect against RPGs or similar threats. In theory, it should actually work to some extent. Those modules are quite heavy, by the way. They can be pulled straight out like this. I can't open them right now, but trust me, they're there. And yes, they really are. As for the rest, the positive changes are proper side protection with reactive armor, a stronger engine, and faster turret traverse speed, which I'll show in a separate video later. Otherwise, it's still the same standard 72, through and through. No radical structural changes like on the T-90. Though inside, yeah, it's noticeably cleaner than that T-90 I showed. The driver has a monitor too. So yeah, that's pretty much it. Everything else looks identical in this regard. The frontal armor layout is identical. Here's the upper plate, the weld seam of the lower plate, and there should be a middle section right here. On both the T-90A and T-72B3, the weld lines and overall dimensions are exactly the same. So yeah, you could say their hulls are basically identical. That's about it. Although I did notice one small difference. On the T-90, right here, instead of a weld seam, there's a milled section. That's the hull roof. It sits slightly higher, and you can see the milling marks. So maybe the hull roof design itself differs here. Basically, they've only fixed the worst flaw, the miserable reactive armor coverage, and that's about it. Up here around the gun mantlet, still no reactive armor coverage. So yeah, that's how it is. Sure, the tank's better, I won't argue that. But those same gaps between the armor blocks are still there. So yeah, almost the same. Almost. Still, I'd say it's a more thoughtful modernization than what we've seen before. That's about it. The crews aren't complaining about the speed. They say it drives fast, shoots accurately, and that's what really matters. So yeah, that's about the whole picture. That's all for today. Share your thoughts in the comments below. If you found this interesting, don't forget to subscribe. And share this video with anyone who loves the tanks and all around it. Thank you for watching. And as always, stay curious.